Okay, welcome to this session. You've already seen the objectives this morning. This means basically understand machine learning if you are new to the field, understand the concept of some methods, being able to apply these machine learning techniques, and also be a bit critical. And on a conference recently, I saw someone presenting a poster, and he presented a model averaging approach based on 78 methods that were in this package Carrot. And I want you, in the end, to be able to judge if this is a meaningful thing, and why yes and why not. So, and there was an email sent around that said you should easy questions you should rather Google. I'm not of that opinion. Please ask anything, even if you think it might be a bit silly, it might be a bit basic. I mean, I traveled here and I'm now here, and please ask and don't be shy. So that's the content of the lecture, and we are going to skip this. And again, I'm going to talk about supervised learning. So we have a response we want to predict, as very well already Hannah explained this morning. And don't expect walking out of here this afternoon and being an expert. I really recommend additional reading. And I gave you some books. A very good introduction is the book of Garrett. It gives you all the background, and he also includes many R coding examples in this book. So, and who likes to know and learn all the mathematical background of these and the mathematical foundation of all these methods, then can go further to the book of Hasty and his colleagues. Basically, the Garrett is a simplification of the book of Hasty for course reasons. And Max Kuhn also provides a book. It's quite it's old, although it's quite heavy, not from the understanding, but it's quite many pages and a lot of prose. But attached with this book is this package Garrett that is very useful to train machine learning methods. And on the website of this of the package Garrett, you find already quite many information in a condensed way as well. And what's also to be mentioned is this overview of Thorsten Hothorn. There are these task views in R that give an overview of all the packages that can do this and that. And this is this task view for machine learning. A lot of packages are most likely not relevant for you because they deal with special cases, but that's always the entrance. Where can I find software that can do something I read in the literature? So, first, we take a step back. If we do spatial modeling, what actually would we need? What should the method be able to do? And my situation was as this. I had quite many things I wanted to map. I had like pH, I had clay content, the depth of the soil, I had a carbon content, and so on. With 300 up to 1,000, roughly up to 1,400 locations that were measured in different depths for three study areas. So many, many statistical models I had to fit. And on the other hand, I really had many, many environmental covariates, depending on the study area, 300 to 500. They were coming in another project. They were using a hyperspectral camera that they mounted on an airplane, and this already yielded 180 bands. And derivatives of that, and derivatives of the elevation model, and so on. So I needed to deal somehow with that situation. So what do we want to do? Basically, we already heard this morning, it's not, the world is not linear, especially in the environment. We want to consider non-linear relationships. Then we are in a spatial setting. We would like to consider spatial autocorrelation. We want to model not just continuous covariates, but also binary or categorical. We want to model soil types or land use or whatever you have as a target. We want to handle all these numerous covariates, and they already know they are correlated. For example, these covariates from this hyperspectral sensor, all these bands, they are highly correlated. What my method should be able to handle that. And I would like to automatically build this, because by hand, it's difficult. And this was the resulting sparse model, this, like a small model that could be maybe open to interpretation. This was asked from the soil surveyor in my case, because they are not so happy with black box and very difficult to models that are very difficult to interpret. This is basically also a requirement. We want to quantify the predictive power, and in the end, actually, we would like to have prediction intervals, so we know the uncertainty at every location. To be honest, so far, I did not find a method that would fulfill all of these requirements. But it really depends on what you do, which point you can maybe neglect. Maybe it's okay to have a very complex model and then have a better predictive power, for example. But just that's the range of requirements we have, and it's quite a long range. So we will see what methods can fulfill and what could not fulfill which points. So I give now a short overview of these machine learning strategies. First, I mean, there are many, many books and so on trying to tidy up. And I just, it's just a way of organize one's thinking. So first, I put the box for linear regression. This is basically ordinary least squares. And I would also add nonlinear models there, because they don't include many terms. They may be nonlinear or linear, but it's very easy to interpret. And I would also put the geostatistics there, because they usually model a linear model, then they model spatial autocorrelation, all the creaking stuff. Then a second box I put for the methods that do dimension reduction. That would be principal components analysis or partial least square, for example. If you have all these correlated covariates, a lot of them are redundant. So principal component analysis basically does a transformation and gives you then transformed covariates that explain roughly the same as all the whole bunch of these correlated covariates. Then regularization and shrinkage. These are usually, it's a group of models that are usually linear models, but they try to make the model as small as possible. So they shrink. We will have a look on such a model later. And the Bayesian methods, they start with prior assumptions. If you already know something of your relationship, you can assume it and then go into the modeling process with that. I further put a box for decision trees, CART, it's classification and regression trees. They are based on splitting your data in smaller and smaller bits. We will see that later with the random forest. Then the neural networks. This is a family of approaches that is usually used also in the unsupervised classification. For example, all these deep learning algorithms and all these suggestions on Spotify or whatever music channel, they're usually done with a method from the neural networks family. Highly complex and usually also highly computational intensive. Then we have these kernel methods, the support vector machines that model highly nonlinear relationships. We will have a look on those later as well. And a very powerful group is the ensembles machine learners. There you find this bootstrap, boosting, and model averaging, and also the random forest is, belongs to this group. There you combine different methods or models of the same type, but you just combine several model fits. That's basically the principle here. And I mean, the stuff above is more or less linear or follows the idea of linear models. And the stuff below, I mean, one decision tree is not yet complex, but if you start to combine the stuff, as you go into neural networks, you move towards high complexity methods. And this is then really usually the core of machine learning. So what's a very important point is overfitting. And I want to be sure you properly understand what is meant with overfitting. I took this figure from the book of Hasty. You have here the prediction error and here the model complexity from low to high. And the blue line is the development of the prediction error on a training sample where you train and calibrate your model. And this means the more complex your model gets, the lower your error gets. Because your model can then adapt to each single data point, the higher the complexity. It can really start to fit everything. And the test sample, it's an independent sample. You did not use for model calibration. You use it for validation. But your predictions, at some point, the error of these predictions getting up again. There is an optimum point where the error on your test sample is the lowest. This means your model has a certain complexity, so it can fit to the data quite well, but it still can be generalized to new observations that the model has not seen. If the model gets too complex, it will not be able to predict anything anymore because it's just adapted to your data set that you have. This can be described in the bias-variance trade-off. Here is the first formula. Please stay with me with formulas. I will explain them through. So, because there is a saying, one loses half of the audience for each formula. I try not to. So here you have a linear model. This is basically demonstrating classification, splitting the blue dots and the orange dots. And of course, if you just fit a linear model, you can never follow the pattern completely. If you here, as an example, just one nearest neighbor cluster analysis, this fits your data completely. It really over adapts to your data. So if you have this model, one says it has a high bias. So this means this is the expectation, basically the mean of your model error. This is a function of x, of your covariates. This is your model, and it has a hat, so it's an estimate. And this is your response, so the response minus your model prediction squared. So it's the mean squared error, this expectation. And it can be split into the bias of your model and the variance of your model. And this, of course, sigma is the part that your model cannot explain. And such a procedure has usually high bias because it's some sort of distorted. If the relationship is not linear, then it is biased. It cannot really cover the true relationship. And this usually has a high variance. You just have to imagine if we change one point, if we change the color of one point, the model changes completely. So high variance means the model is flipping around if we have small changes in the data. And if we do machine learning, we move from this side here, from like classical statistics, rather high bias, but very stable procedure, we move into this direction. But we have to handle somehow this flippiness of the models. So now this is the list of methods I'm going to introduce, and they have different properties regarding bias and variance. Are there questions so far? Then I continue. So the lasso is basically a model selection tool for linear regression. This means it does shrinkage, and this means it does a downweighting of the coefficients. So let me explain. Basically, for the lasso estimates, we just use a linear model, but we get a different estimate of the coefficients, this beta. And this is basically the normal, ordinary least squares regression. We have a y minus the beta 0, which is the intercept of the regression, and the x, the covariates, times the coefficient to this covariate. So this is a normal regression with several covariates, like 2, 3, etc. And of course, we minimize, in an ordinary least squares regression, we minimize this error squared. So. And for the lasso, we have an additional term. This is this lasso penalty. We sum up the absolute value of all the coefficients and put a tuning parameter that is called lambda. This means how much we want to penalize. And these beta, these coefficients, why does it matter? Just imagine if you have elevation and temperature. They're correlated, but just to the opposite. And this means if you put them both into your normal ordinary least squares model, they might have very high coefficients, but just equaling out. And your model fit then gets unstable. That's the situation with a normal ordinary least squares regression. If you put correlated covariates into it, the fit gets unstable because they can just get big and start to wobble around, let's say. And if you put a weight or a penalty on that, they are forced to be low. So we can put correlated covariates into the model, and the coefficients are penalized, they are shrunken. Now, this is the main tuning parameter. How much shrinkage should we apply? How much should we force them to become small, the coefficients? And this can be found by applying a cross-validation on your data. And if we iterate through this shrinkage factor, this is basically, if we do not do any shrinkage, we end up with the normal least squares regression. And if we shrink, the coefficients, as you can see here, they could just become lower, and they can even become zero. This means that the covariate just falls out of the model. It's out if it has a zero coefficient. So this is like the development of the path of the loss of it, and now we have to know where is the optimal shrinkage and which one should be zero.
The shrinkage corresponds to this sum of penalties?
Yes, yeah. It's just here in the book they used the shrinkage factor S, which is a transformation to the lambda here. Here you have the log of the lambda, and this is the cross-validation error. And as you go through the lambda, you can see here the number of groups, the number of covariates you have in the model. You find a minimum error at roughly 70 covariates. But maybe if you really want to have a very small model, starting from this 400, and from the splitting in the cross-validation, you have it's a random splitting. So you have a certain fluctuation there. And this is given by these error intervals here. And then you can just go over here and take the smallest model, which is still then considered an optimum. And then has only 25 covariates remaining in the model, if your aim is really going for a small model. That's how the lambda can be determined. So what's the pros and cons? It's, from my experience, it's very fast. The algorithm to fit all that, including the cross-validation, was one of the fastest algorithms I applied to my data. It selects covariates, so your model will be narrower than in the beginning. You don't have any problems with collinearity because it can deal with it. It has an easy interpretation. This means you can show it to someone that is familiar with ordinary least squares, that is familiar with classical statistics, and they will be able to read it. And you can fit it even if you have little data points and you have many covariates. A normal ordinary least squares regression, you cannot, there is no solution if you have 50 data points and 100 covariates. Here, this is possible with this algorithm. But disadvantages, we are still in the linear modeling framework. If you have positively skewed data, you need transformations. Otherwise, it's assumed to have normally distributed Gaussian errors. Otherwise, you violate model assumptions. And it's only linear. Even if you put a lot of covariates, there are, I don't know, discussions in the books that it tends to non-linearity. But if you have a simple model in the end of 25 covariates remaining, it's a linear model. And it cannot cover the non-linear relationships. And from my experience, sometimes the fits were a bit weird, and I had to go into it and adjust a bit the lambdas and give other starting parameters. Sometimes, I don't know, but it's a matter of application. According to theory, it should all work fine, but then you end up with strange stuff. And I found it was rather underfitting. This means the complexity of the model is not high enough to really capture the data. And the further disadvantage, it does not provide prediction errors. You cannot get prediction intervals directly from the method. You have to approximate it by bootstrap simulation. This is a topic I would discuss in the blocks tomorrow. And it's not a spatial method. That's also a disadvantage. It does not directly include, and also in the cross-validation, it does not directly consider the spatial aspect, as Hannah demonstrated this morning. So, are there questions on the lasso?
It's not very clear to me how you select lambda. Sorry.
You basically, you create cross-validation sets,
yeah.
And then you compute predictions with different lambdas, and you compute for all these predictions, you compute the error, and from that you get somewhere an optimum error.
So yes.
But there is software that does it directly. It even provides this plot directly. So. Further questions? Okay, then we...
The transformation key, the first quick one, you should transform also the covariates if they're not normally distributed.
This is a general thing, not only related to lasso. I would say yes if they are extremely, strongly positively cued. Yeah. There is the if model violations are mainly introduced by positively skewed response, for example. But I had situations where the model fits became very unstable with different methods. I really saw jumpy behavior in the tuning parameter selection, and this was because of heavily positively skewed covariates. Then I just decided to transform them. There is no harm done with that. Just interpretation is maybe a bit hampered, and then it got much more stable. More questions? So we proceed to the support vector machines. I think they have become quite popular as well. Here I have an image of the support vector classifier. We start with the linear setting, and it's basically you have a covariate X and X1 and the covariate X2, and you have these two groups, the pink and the blue points. And the aim is to separate these two groups based on X1 and X2. And what this support vector classifier aims to do is to find the line that is the furthest apart of all the observation points. And to build up this line, the model then defines the closest points. These are called then the support vectors. And the distance between the closest points and this the furthest separating line is called the margin. So, and this is now the setting with two covariates. If you have more covariate, then the algorithm searches for a hyperplane, which is then just like the same stuff in more dimensions. But the problem here is now, if we have one pink point over here, there is no, this algorithm doesn't have any solution because it cannot separate the two groups by a line. So there is a relaxation to the criterion that the groups should be completely separable, and this is introduced with a tuning parameter in the algorithm. This tuning parameter is usually called a C, and this is just the amount of wrongly classified or just violations we accept. If C is large, then we accept many points to be on the wrong side of the margin or on the wrong side of the separating line. And if C becomes more narrow, we do not accept that many violations anymore. And so, like this, we can more or less then separate our data in this binary setting. Now, we have a problem with if in a setting like this, the points cluster very, very well, but still we have no chance by separating them by a line. So we are in a non-linear setting. And what the support vector machines then do, instead of just using linear separating and linear hyperplanes, they introduce kernel functions. And this basically looks like this for the same data as before. Instead of a line, you have a separating kernel, and again with the margins. And this introduces then the second tuning parameter, which is sigma. This is the smoothness of this kernel. This means the higher the sigma, the more these kernels are able to adapt to your data, the lower you tend towards a linear setting. This means, again, we have like the C, this violation parameter we need to optimize, and the sigma. So the pros and cons of this method. I also found it quite fast, a bit less fast than the lasso. And it's what I think it's one main advantage, it's robust to outliers. Just to go back, if we use these points that are just near to the line for the fitting, this means a point that is over here doesn't really play a role. And it also, if it would be over here or even further away from the distribution, this is doesn't change the model fit. It's only the points that are the support vectors that build up the model.
If there's a model of a point at the other side, that's an extreme outlier.
Then a pink on this side, this is considered with the soft margin classifier, it's considered a violation and depends on your C tuning parameter, how far apart it is allowed to be. I'm not too sure. I don't think so. Because it's considered a violation, and if your C parameter allows for that, it's considered not relevant to estimate the actual model. Because it is just really built up by the support vectors, and if this point is not considered a support vector, it doesn't build up the model. Therefore, it is quite a robust method for... if you have outliers in your data. And of course it's nonlinear, and you can even tune the nonlinearity, how much nonlinearity should be in the model. From the literature, if you look at the paper, at least in my field, I expect quite good predictive power. If they do this model comparisons, it's usually one of the best. And it just has 1 to 2 tuning parameters, depending if you're linear or nonlinear. So a disadvantage, if you give in 500 covariates, it will use 500. It does not select. And if you have a model with 500 covariates, you have difficulties with interpretation. Again, we do not have any standard errors defined. They need, again, to be derived with a simulation, with a bootstrap. And also the spatial modeling is not covered. It's not per se a spatial method. Are there questions on the support vector machine so far?
It's just a classifier, right?
No, it can also handle continuous responses. So far, I just used it for that. But it came out of the classification environment. More questions?
Standard errors not defined.
This means if you want to have prediction intervals with your prediction, it does not come out of the method. It's not like if in geostatistics with a Krieging you have the Krieging variances, and they give you the standard errors directly. More questions? Yes. I just showed it because most of the explanation in the textbook is for the binary case. But there is then an expansion of the algorithm to the multi-category case, where you have a response with several categories. And the expansion from this case also expands then to continuous response. But the software is available to fit it directly. But for me, it's... the method, the newest method, I looked into it, and to be honest, is the one I understand. I'm not quite there with the full understanding. So, now we proceed to the ensemble learners. And ensemble learners means we combine method with different methods or the same method differently formed with different strategies. And this especially is meaningful if you have this complex procedures that do not in general have a bias but have a high variance. This means the ones that jump around if we have small changes in the data. And for example, trees are usually such a procedure. We can then combine these different procedures with either bagging. This is a shortcut for bootstrap aggregation. This is based on resampling the data. This means you take a sample from your data with replacement and you fit the model procedure you choose onto that new data. And in the end, you combine all these models by, for example, taking an average. Random forest is such a procedure. We will look on that later. Then we can use gradient boosting. This is an adaptive strategy that does a forward learning. It tests possible models, then it just adds the best one, and it steps forward just by adding the best one, the best one, the best one. And it does that in a clever way, and therefore is also quite powerful. And the model averaging is just you fit a bunch of very different models and you combine them somehow by, for example, just taking the average. So random forest is based on classification and regression trees. These are like the basic elements, and they are built up by recursive binary splitting of the data set. This means you always split your data into two groups, and then you have a new subgroup, and then you split this into another subgroup, and then you continue splitting into other subgroups until you end up with only a small amount of observations where you start to split. And for each split, you use a new covariate, and you try to find an optimal covariate there. And the random forest grows then a large number of such trees. By default, this is usually 500. And now, so we should not have all very similar trees, but we want to be them the furthest apart as possible. This means it uses this resampling from the bagging, taking samples of your original data set and then fitting to this sample. And for the tree splits, it only uses a subset of the covariates. This is this M-tri tuning parameter. And the prediction in the end is then just an average over all trees, or if you are in the classification setting, you just use a majority vote of all these trees. No, in random forest, no pruning is introduced. The pruning would be if you grow just one tree. And I mean, here on this icon, you can grow this tree very deeply. And then up to the last data point, basically. There should be, pruning is then the rule where you stop to grow the tree. But in random forest, the trees are all fully grown. Unless you set the node size to a certain, I show that later. So this is basically the algorithm. You resample your data. This means take a sample of your original data of the same size, and you take a random sample of your covariates. And this random sample has the size of M-tri, that's your tuning parameter. Let's say, usually this is one-third of your covariates, that's the default value. It means if you have 60 covariates, it takes 20 at random, that are then tried to split the data in two optimal groups. And by splitting, here, imagine if you have like rainfall, distribution from 500 to 1,000, it iterates through all possible splits, and then takes the one with the lowest mean squared error. And it compares all these covariates and takes the one that splits them with the lowest mean squared error, the best one it takes for the split. Then, again, it continues here. Again, it takes a random subsample of 20 of this M try, and again tries all of them and takes the best for the split. And it stops when you have, for example, 5 observation points in a leaf, this is called. This would be the node size. It can be used more than once, but you have at every split point you have a random selection, and if from the initial group, and if it's not in the random selection, it has to wait until the next split. That's how these trees are decorrelated, and are. This means like not if you would just not do that, the trees would look very similar, because then always the same covariates would jump up at the same splits. So that's why you omit part of those, and then other covariates can come in.
So each one of the 500 trees is decorrelated with the other ones?
Yes. Through these two random factors, one's the resampling, and one, this random selection of covariates. So not all can be used at each split. Yes, yeah, you can repeat it. So we use it for a split, then we just continue until we grow the tree fully, and we repeat it for secondary sampling, so on. We do that 500 times. This means it leaves us with the main tuning parameters. This is this M try, how many covariates we are randomly selecting. And it's the M-try is the most relevant tuning parameter. The N-tree, the number of trees you grow. For my work, this was usually not so sensitive. Default values within most packages are 500. If you don't have capacity to tune, you should just leave that out. And also the node size. That's usually around 5, the default value. That's also usually not so sensitive. So how do we do the tuning? We do not use cross-validation here, but we can use the out-of-bag error, which is very similar. So what's that? I put here a bit technical definition of the out-of-bag error from the Book of Hasty. It's basically nothing else than you have your original data set, you take this through this resampling, you take at random, and some of your data points are then duplicated, triplicated, and so on, and some of your data points are not taken at all. And so roughly 30% of your data points are not taken at all in one resampling round. This means you can grow all your tree, and you still have roughly 30% of your data that has not been used for this tree. This means we fit then the tree and have still this out-of-bag data. And we can then compute the prediction error on this out-of-bag data that gives us some sort of independent, or gives us some sort of validation error, like in a cross-validation. So, for me, random forest, if you do not too much tuning, it always depends on that. It's also quite the fast method. And what it does, it models interactions between the covariates and some sort of they're also nonlinear relationships. This means if you have rainfall, and then you have a second split is the geology, and then you have a third split, the land use. So you model interactions between all these covariates, because these splits depend on each other. And like this, you can cover new relationships that we did not have in the model before. And from the applied modeling, environmental modeling literature, it's expected to have very good predictive performance. In model comparison, it's usually the best. It yields covariate importance out of the modeling directly, and makes covariate selection possible. This is a thing I would show tomorrow. And for continuous responses out of this resampling approach, you can directly derive prediction intervals from this. It's called quantile regression forest. But again, it's difficult to interpret if you do not do any covariate selection by on its own. If you add 500, it will use all the 500. And even if there is good predictive performance, do proper validation. Don't trust everything that is coming out of a random forest. Again, it's not a spatial method.
MTRI,
yeah. Or that's the thing that is most relevant. Or even if you do by default, it's usually 1/3 of the covariates that are used. And even a fit like that is usually quite good. And if you do the training for some responses, you will gain something. For some, it's the gain in accuracy is not too much. Here, the image is basically as a regression. The dark dots are large values, and the fair dots are small values. And what you basically do at each split, you try to split the group by minimizing the mean squared error. This means for each group, you calculate the mean, yeah. And then you check for these two means, which the mean is basically the prediction in each leaf. You check what has the smallest squared error, like in a classical regression. It's like in an ANOVA. And of course, for the categoricals, for a binary classification, you count the votes or the misclassified. Further questions? Yes, but this is something different for the uncertainty for the continuous variables. I said you can derive prediction intervals for every prediction location. This means you get intervals for every new prediction. And the confusion matrix you would use on a validation set, on a test set, you would check how well you are able to predict your validation points. That's like computing an R square. Yes. But I usually use the out of the bag for the tuning, but then I still have an independent test set that has never seen anything of the model. Because if you do the tuning on your whole data, some sort of it will adapt to your model. Further questions? Then we continue with the boosting algorithm. Gradient boosting basically works like this. You compute the residuals of your model, or when you start, you compute the mean, and you take just the residuals to the mean. You fit base learners. Base learners, that's how they term these basic elements, are basically any kind of function. This can be just a linear model. This can be a spline. This can be even a tree, and you can define how deep the tree should be grown. Then you select the best fitting one, and add this one to the model. And with, instead of just adding it, it shrinks the effect to not being added in 100%. It's, for example, just added as 10%. So this means it is learning in a weak way, and this means it should not be overfitting. If you add the effect, it adapts to your data too fast. And this is like the main element of boosting, that it's a forward selection, like you would also maybe know from linear regression of the function step, that just includes the best fitting ones, but they are included or not included. But here, all the effects are just a little bit included. But they can then in the next round, if you have rainfall that is important, it can be selected again and again and again. But in between, you can then also select geology and so on and build up your model. Basically, then you have to find the optimal numbers of iteration, which is then the main tuning parameter here. Or usually something you have to tune on your base learners. For example, if you add trees, you need to define how deep the trees should be grown here. So this means we can add trees exactly. And I show a small example. Here, these are observation points from the value range from pH. And I calculate the mean, and I center the data points around the mean. Then I show them to my covariates, and I compute here nonlinear, here linear relationships, and I test all of them, and I select the best fitting one. And this I add to my model. And instead of adding it fully, like in a normal forward regression, I just add it by 10%. I make the effect smaller. But then, and then I compute the residuals, and I start again. And I add the next one, and so on. And the same can be chosen again if it's important. So, if you do gradient boosting, we now look into it how it can be done with. We can add linear terms, we can add non-linear terms as spline functions. Maybe some of you know the GAM, generalized additive models. This is basically a way how to select such a GAM. But we can also then add spatial terms. This is a smooth surface. It's basically a spline of your coordinates in a 2D. This looks then like this. You have your observation. I put here the red kite because this was published with breeding locations of a red kite they were modeling in this paper. This means you have the breeding of the red kite at the location S, and you can model it as a function of your environmental covariates that are either linear or smooth. And then you can also add this spatial surface, and you can even add interactions between your spatial surface and your covariates. This means you can have locally varying coefficients. For example, if you have, again, certain land use is predicting the breeding of the red kite. In the north of your study area, maybe the land use has a different effect than in the south. So you can differentiate locally the covariates in space. This can be partial residual plots can be plotted. This is also a topic of tomorrow, so it's easy for interpretation, even if it's nonlinear. Here is an example from this paper that you get an idea how such spatial surfaces look like. This is the study area, and you can see the moving coefficients that are not the same for the complete study area. But still, the pattern is not so small scale. those effects are added in addition to the other effects into the model. So finally, we would say we have a machine learning tool that can include the spatial setting we are looking for. And it even selects covariates, but not very strongly. So if I started with 300, I maybe ended up with 80 or something like that. The models were still not so small. And it is also simple for interpretation. But yes, it's low. It takes a lot of setup. I put it in the exercises, but you will see it's a lot of coding. I don't know, it was a bit difficult to fit, and so on. It seems it's biased if you have categorical covariates. If you, for example, have land use classes, geology, it groups them into one base learner, and depending on how many classes, they are rarely selected. And even if interpretation would be easy, if there are 80 covariates, it's still difficult to interpret. And it's again a parametric method. It assumes normally distributed errors, so you have to care about transformation if your response is positively skewed. And we also miss prediction intervals here. So, yes, I was enthusiastic, or my previous boss as well, but in the end it did not turn out that well. But this would be a method that includes spatial setting as such. So, but what do we do when we add trees as a base learners? What's the comparison to a random forest? This is implemented in XGBoost, usually a package that is often used. So the boosted trees, it seems they select covariates, because in this forward selection procedure, not all of the covariates are selected. This does not really happen with random forest. Random forest usually uses everything. We have a covariate importance. That's the same as for a random forest, because this for tree-based procedures, this comes out. We, from my experience, prediction accuracy is usually it's a bit lower. It's not very bad, but it's a bit lower than a random forest. Prediction uncertainty can only be done with a bootstrapping again. As with random forest, we can use this quantile regression forest. And it's from the theory, because it's a forward learning algorithm, it adapts to your residuals. This means it tries to model what was not explained in the previous part. So it's expected it should reduce bias in your model fit. I did not really see that too much in my model experience, but that's from the book what should happen. As while random forest, as opposed to it always fits to the same data distribution, because it's a resampling of the original data, not a fit to the residuals. For speed, yes, I did not do any benchmarking here. It depends how much you tune random forest and also the boosting. So we are coming to the model averaging. Any questions on the boosting? Okay. Okay, yeah, we can have a large question right then. The model averaging is basically combining different methods with some strategy. And the idea behind there is that different methods, you have a certain correlation structure in your data, and different methods catch different aspects of your correlation structure. So you have some linearities, you have some non-linearities, you have some interactions. And if you use possibly different methods, all of them catch some of your structure. But most likely, not one method can catch everything. So if you combine, this is the assumption that you end up with a better model. And for linear regression, there is even the mathematical proof: if you combine different linear models, the model that comes out, or the predictions that come out, are superior to the single models. But of course, for machine learning, we don't really know. So we just have to test, and it depends on your data. So how can we combine? The simplest, we just take the mean. You compute predictions for several models, you take the mean and check if this is superior to the single models. Or you do a bit more an intelligent choice. You consider the model performance of your single models. For example, you do a weighting with the inverse of the mean squared error. This means if the mean squared error is low, it gets a higher weight in the it's an awaited mean. There are also approaches if you have prediction intervals, and usually the model is in your study area, the model is not everywhere predicting with the same performance. So you can locally adapt the averaging. But it's it depends, or you need prediction intervals to do that. You could even set up from your predictions, you can set up a new linear model, combining them and estimating coefficients. Or there are also other approaches called stack generalization or Bayesian approaches that you could go into a next step of modeling. But from what I've seen from the literature already, with a simple mean or with a weighted mean, you're already quite good. This with comparison in one paper, so this would not increase the performance that much, considering the effort. So that's simple and straightforward and easy to test, and if it's nothing, you just drop. So now I indicated, and also Hanna this morning, that most machine learning methods, they have not been developed as spatial methods. So what can we do with spatial correlation? What is often seen is that you apply machine learning, and then you check in your residuals if there is still some spatial autocorrelation. And then you apply a Krieging step. But with this, I'm not so happy, because it's two independent modeling steps. If you want to compute prediction intervals, you also have to consider that, and so on. And the machine learning method does not consider spatiality. What is often done, the X and Y coordinates are added to the model. You just add as this. But what happened, at least with my predictions, and what's also seen in some test computations of Tom Hengel, you end up in some sort of chessboard artifacts. Because if you, especially for tree-based methods, random forest, boosted trees, it starts to split like this on your map. In the end, you have a chessboard. Which is, if you show that to someone, they think, oh, okay, my model performance is good, but looks a bit silly, your map most likely not trustworthy. So an ad hoc method to have like some sort of a workaround, just rotate the coordinates. And add, instead of just two, add a set of six rotated axes just by cosinus-sinus transformations. So at least it doesn't split always north-south and east-west. But still not very satisfactory. And as I showed, adding this smooth surface of the coordinates, it's not really able to fit the small-scale pattern. And if you allow it to fit the small-scale pattern, it's most likely overfitting. So it was also not so successful. So for me, none of this is really satisfactory. And this is... just to let you know, from my point of view, I also recently asked around in a spatial data expert group. I don't see a satisfactory solution of the problem yet. But consider, if you work with spatial data, you have to check if it's really handled correctly and if your predictions do not end up in nonsense. So I hope you know a little bit more what's the meaning of all these words. And maybe we can now discuss what you think about fitting all 80 models in Garrett and create a model averaging. Is it a good idea or not, and why? Yes, yes. Especially, I mean, if you fit all these methods, most of them are likely redundant. So they will not cover any new, or they will not find any new relationship you haven't been modeled already. And most likely, instead of fitting all these models, maybe check out if you cannot add an additional covariate that explains more. Ask someone that has domain knowledge of your topic. And maybe they say, you have to add this, or you can compute something. Make a new derivative of your elevation model that is targeted on your response. That might help much more. Yes, what do you, how do you define a simple problem?
For example, a combination of bands of sentiment 2 mm-hmm. estimate better a kind of algae in the water that could be readable because mm-hmm. of a pigment. That's just the one variable, you have mm-hmm. Data from the lab. Mm-hmm. But you need like the best combination of bands to retrieve that variable from.
Mm-hmm. If you do just the lasso, you might miss nonlinear relationships. You might miss interactions. Mm-hmm. But maybe you already have prior knowledge. Then you can add the square root of your covariate into the model, or the square, or some transformation. Then you can go still fit the linear model, but go beyond nonlinearity. And also interactions could be added. But you need to know to have prior knowledge. But it depends on the purpose. I was also modeling, trying to find simple functions, because the person that wanted to use the model in the end, he was only mastering Excel. Mm-hmm. So I had to provide him something, a simple linear regression he was able to apply with his pocket calculator. And so I fitted a boosting model to check if there are non-linear relationships, and then from that I built a linear model by transforming then the covariates in by square, by okay. and so on. But all these methods can also be used to explore and then to build the final model.
Below. Take care and never fit on validation set.
Yes.
But in one of the methods you explained before, one with trees, that is
the out of pack. Yes.
Because what I think she actually does, which is a little bit different from what Anna was mentioning, is that she divided the whole data set in three things: training data set and then validation.
Yeah, but it's randomly split the data set.
Say again?
The data set is divided randomly, right?
My strategy is usually to take away a validation set that is not used for anything, not for tuning, not for finding any weights. And this validation set, the best way would be to go and take new samples. And it should be completely independent from your previous data. But this is often not possible. So what I did, I was then taking a meaningful validation set that was evenly spread all over my study area. So I did not take it completely at random, but I applied some spatial weighting for the random sample. And this validation set, I did not use in any step. And then on the calibration set, you can compute cross-validation errors, you can compute out-of-bag errors, and so on. You do, on this calibration set, you start to do the data splitting for the model tuning. And here, what I said, because you already did a lot of model tuning on your calibration set by subsplitting all this calibration set, and if you want to find the optimal weights here, or a new linear fit, a new linear regression, and know which models you should include or not, you don't have any data left to test that, because you already included all your calibration data in previous model steps, and you don't have any independent data. This means to really tune those, you would need a calibration set to build and tune all your machine learning methods. Then you would need a data set to find your optimal weights. Then you would need a very independent validation set to estimate your error you do with the prediction. Yeah, but it's like the optimal case would always be going out and taking new samples with completely maybe stratified at random sampling design. That is completely independent from whatever you use for modeling.
And another one, that is on support vector machine.
Yeah.
On slide 25.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't really interpret well the picture.
Sorry, too many clicks. This one, or?
Yeah, the following. The dashed line.
This is the dashed lines are basically the margin. And the margin is where your support vectors lie. They built up the model. And so with the dashed lines, this is basically the support vectors are located there. And the width of this margin is then controlled again with the C parameter. And of course, they are also, for the radial functions, they are also circular. Because it's a radial function and not a linear function, these margins are also circular. Further questions? Then I suggest we take a break, and then after the break you continue with doing the exercises just at your own speed, and I circulate to support you. I quickly since maybe not everybody takes the same duration for the break, I quickly explain. I brought a data set. It's our soil sampling sites from the 70s up to now. Nearby Bern, and they include quite a lot of covariates. Not all of them. I was not allowed to publish everything. And so you can practice on a data set that has quite many covariates, but don't be disappointed. The correlation between your response and the covariates is rather weak. But this is previous knowledge. And you find all the R code in the R file, and you find also this RNV file. This I used to produce the complete PDF. So I don't know, there was most likely no block on NITR. NITR is a way how you can combine R and LaTeX and then get an output that is collect all your results directly into PDF or with a markdown as a website, as a Word document. So this is also that you can see or use that as a template for yourself. So. And to be honest, the codes are quite complex, but I decided not to simplify because in certain cases this would lead to inferior programming. I gave some explanations how some stuff is done. It even includes some parallel computing. But I let it in, so you have all these examples, so you can build on that. If you do not understand, don't be shy to ask. Okay, then I suggest a break.